half uur voor het gesprek, maar ik heb net gehoord dat het 20 minuten moet. Dus ja, dan weet ik dat ook wel. Op 17 september 1992 vond een bijzondere gebeurtenis plaats in Frankfurt in Duitsland. Er werd namelijk de première gespeeld van het samenwerkingsproject van Frank Zappa met Ensemble Modern en de Yellow Shark. En bij dat project was de dirigent, de gast hier aanwezig, Peter Rundel. Dus uiteraard gaan we zeer uitgebreid nu, dat wil zeggen zolang de tijd toestaat, praten over dat project. Pieter, ik moet even bijzeggen, we doen de vragen in het Engels en de antwoorden ook, wordt niet vertaald of niks, dus we gaan ervan uit dat u allemaal het Engels verstaat.
Yes, I hope that it's alright if I speak English, and I hope more that my quite poor English is mentioned to such a complex subject than Frank Zappa.
We do our best.
Alright.
Peter, can you shortly explain how the contact with Frank Zappa was made, how the initiative was taken, and how the contacts were made with Zappa?
Of course, it's a long history. I try to make it as short as possible.
Please.
And I'm very bad at dates, so I think it was 3 years before the actual personal contact was made. The ensemble that played pieces by Frank Zappa was part of the Frankfurt Fest, and it was in the program with a lot of other composers. That was the first experience with the music of Frank Zappa from the Ensemble Modern. And then, that time there was the director of the Frankfurt Fest, it was Peter Rundel, and he had the plan to make a composer's portrait of Frank Zappa in 1992. He had that plan, and he wanted to do a lot of things, all the orchestral stuff, and ensemble music, and there was also some money to give commission. And the contact was made to Frank Zappa through Henny Dona, which did this documentary film about Frank. And some CDs tapes were sent to Frank Zappa. And, well, he obviously was interested, he liked it, and then our managers that get together went to Los Angeles, they tried to make the logistic clear, and then came the offer from Frank. He said, well, if you want to do the project, you have to come. You have to come to Los Angeles for 2 weeks. I have to try you out. It's not, I know you are good players, but I have to see what else I can do with you. So,
but at that point, was everybody enthusiastic about working with Frank Zappa and the ensemble? Did everybody know, for instance?
There was, yes, I think maybe 80% of the that really knew him and admired him and knew his music. We had some really hardcore Zappa fans there, and also some, of course, some people which really didn't know him as a composer. But they were like very often. I mean, they were. We wanted to do it, and they were willing to try.
So the first personal contact that the members of the ensemble had with Zappa was in July 1991.
That's right. It went very shortly. We had to decide within 3 days if we wanted to do that project or not, because we actually planned to go for our holidays, which are anyway very short. We had these 2 weeks, and then we got together and we decided, well, we take the risk, because it was a risk, it was a financial risk, because he was, at that time, it was very clear, and he was very open about that. He was very ill, and he didn't know if the project, would happen anyway because of his serious illness, and he said, well, it might happen, it might not happen, but let's go for it. Mm-hmm. And so we went there.
So then you flew to Los Angeles, you arrived at this place. What did happen?
Of course, we were quite nervous about it, because the only thing he told us, well, I want these instruments, it's exactly the second you see here, you will hear after that talk on stage. that I want, you know, mandolin and also bring all the instruments, your additional instruments you play. I mean, we brought things like the, you know, alpon and timbalon and didgeridoos and things like that. Bring everything with it. But we didn't have any music. It was nothing. So we didn't know what was going on then. And after, you know, we went to Joe's garage where we rehearsed there. And he came in, introduced himself, and then he wrote, you know, for everyone, he gave everyone a sheet of music paper. It was a very simple piece, it was called This is a Test. And it was quite a simple piece, free atonal style, a bit neoclassicistic, I would say. It was just to check out if we are able to cycle it out. And then we played it and we took it away. And he tried other things. Actually, from day to day, he came with more complicated work out his course. We also tried some old pieces like the wind quintets, things which already existed, string quartets. And I think after a short time he was quite convinced that written music, that he could play quite complicated stuff. But then he was very much interested in what we couldn't do.
So did you start testing your improvisation dance already then?
Exactly, that's what happened. And of course we are not an improvisation group. Of course there are some members of the Ensemble Modern who have a background that can do, you know, can improvise in a certain style, but there are others which never did it before actually. And he was very, very interested to find out like always, I think it's quite important, where the borders are, where the limitations are, is there a way to overcome that, you know. I have to say, it was not easy for musicians, of course, because it was, we were sitting there, the tape was running all the time, it was like always in his life, everything was, you know, documented, also the film, you know, the video was running. But in a way, he succeeded. He was a very fine communicator of his ideas. And just through being himself, slowly, the confidence, we got the confidence and he got the confidence, you know, that that's all right, whatever we do, you know.
Is it true that he even played guitar in that phase of your college?
That's right. Within the 2 weeks, he himself played the guitar, just, you know, to demonstrate things. I think that was also part of what we did there. We very slowly got used to accept his idiomatic style. Mm-hmm. I mean, we saw this the musicians which play the music and know that you have these very complex rhythms and you don't have articulations, you don't have dynamics. And then we took the guitar and just played, you know, and it sounded totally different than we tried to do, you know. And slowly we got acquainted with it, with his language, which is a very, you know, very personal, idiomatic thing. And
But then it's not true that you played guitar solos when you were.
He did that too. Yes, but not too much. I mean, it wasn't. It was clear for him that he wouldn't be a player on stage, so he just did that maybe to overcome some tensions or whatever, you know, mm-hmm. just to make us feel better.
Yeah. The arrangements, most of the arrangements are made by Mr. Eli Askin. I don't know if I pronounced his name correct. Mm-hmm. Does he work with the ensemble or did Zappa bring?
No, we brought him in. Actually, I don't remember the name. The name he had a guy, you know, in the background writing the music mm-hmm. and doing arrangements. But as it work was in progress, showed that he would, that he was really complicated and slow. And we knew, and I asked him, we knew he would be a good person. And we brought him, we just, you know, after 3 days, we gave him a call, please come, we need you. And he's very good, you know, in writing music with the computers and all this, and also he was a fantastic gear. He was, you know, sitting there when we were improvising and, you know, writing some outlines and writing them all down. Yes, and then finally he got the commission from where Frank asked him, can't you do an arrangement of this? And because Frank himself was more interested in his new pieces, but it was from a certain point on, it was clear that the evening would also have, you know, some arranged old pieces, and we gave Ali that finished.
So the first pieces that you really rehearsed were new pieces of Zappa. Not the older ones, not the arrangement.
Well, it depends when. In these 2 weeks, there were no new pieces. In these first 2 weeks, back in 91, there were no new pieces. There were old pieces, and there were, in a way, there were formulas and sounds developed, you know, which we all wrote down, and he also tried to write down. But these were sketches, raw sketches, material, which, for instance, Get Wiley, which came out of that. You know, it's based on actually an improvisation pattern we developed there, you know.
Out of the program book of the Yellow Shark, I got the impression, out of short notes of ensemble members, that the musicians of Ensemble Modern were very skeptical about the way Zappa approached you in the first 2 weeks. Is that correct or not?
In a way that's correct. There were moments which were really great, but there were also moments, you know, where we didn't know at all where this whole thing would go to. Mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't clear if there would be. We wanted new pieces, you know, and there wasn't. He didn't came out. He brought this material and improvised, and you know, he didn't put things really together. And maybe we're a little bit too much impatient, you know. Also, because of his serious illness, there were also moments where he just couldn't go on working, you know. He just left the studio and, you know, we worked for ourselves. We didn't know when he would be able to come back. And he came back and work went on. But I have to say, you know, concerning his illness, that his... His self-control was enormous. Mm-hmm. It was enormous. He never, in all the time I saw him really lost. You know, and I saw him without humor. He was always there, always bright, always. He had a big charm, and you know, he just had to stop at some point. And you know, he came back, and he wasn't like before. Very professional.
But when he was so ill that he had to leave the rehearsals, you work for yourself, you say. What did you work on then?
Well, for instance, we had this, you know, woodwind quintet, which other songs played before, and he wanted to know, I mean, how you play that music, and also he worked. Then when he could play it, he worked on the style we performed it very much. Mm-hmm. And I have to say that from a lot of his music, if you just see the music, very often they are without dynamic, without articulation, and he added a lot of things in the work. Do this, do that sample, then do that crescendo. Sometimes we didn't recognize the piece after that again. You know, it was a completely different thing.
When were the first pieces introduced? When did you start to play the first pieces?
Well, you probably know, I don't remember the date, but in 92 we had these sessions in Frankfurt, and he came to Frankfurt for that. And already for that session, there were, I think, I hope I'm right, there were, you know, Get Whitey and outrage of bodies, and also the arrangements that were there.
But the program wasn't set already then?
No. The program was, the final program was set on the day before the premiere. Because we also worked on pieces which we didn't perform in the end. Mm-hmm. I mean, I remember first piece, it was also a symphony piece called Chinese the Wings, and we worked for hours on that piece in Armenia. And it didn't work. it was so difficult. And it was also a part of the work we had, in many cases, we had to convince him that our attitude or our way to work a piece is completely different than what he was used to, obviously, because very often we tried complicated, play complicated pieces, like, for instance, in America, we played it the first time. It's a very difficult piece, symphony piece. And we played it, and he said, well, no, let's skip that. We lose our time, we will never work, we will never work. He very often said, and we said, okay, Frank, be patient, we will work tomorrow, and you believe, we will listen, it will be a little bit better. And in some cases we succeeded, in some not.
And in the end, he didn't put America, which was played in the program then. It wasn't put on the CD.
Yes. I really don't know. It might have not been satisfying enough for him, but I know that the live version of America with Ensemble Modern will come out on the coming CD. Probably he reworked it in his studio. It's very possible, because he had the samples of. That's what he did also have to say in Los Angeles. He sampled each player for his sample library for hours. Each player, his instruments, sounds, he wanted everything. And so he has this quite amazing sound library, so to call. And it's possible that in the case of America, he worked on that and, made things better in the studio.
I know that you once said that you reckon Frank Zappa to one of the most important composers, and that you don't hesitate to put him in the same row as people like Stravinsky and Ives. Well, you could mention, of course, other names. Can you explain why he is so important as a musician?
That's always the question they want to know from me. They want to know is Frank Zappa like Ligeti, or is he like Zappa? And I think one very important, I could say, as I said, yes, but it's only half of the truth, because I could say, well, there's this piece and this piece, and it's at least, worked out than a piece like Ligeti, but I think the important thing about Frank Zappa is that he wasn't only a composer. I mean, you have to. For me, he changed music history. I mean, he's a little bit like maybe Miles Davis or Jimi Hendrix, or he opened doors. In not only music, but also in thinking. Mm-hmm. And I think what is very important about him, and I hope that it becomes more important even in the future, is the idea that the separation between so-called serious music and entertaining lights, whatever you call it, I mean, in his view, this separation was just ridiculous. And it is. I think he was against the beauty and against against the pathos of the serious music. It has something very ridiculous, that, and he clearly saw that. And he also, I think, he hated some rituals from rock or jazz music. I mean, everything which is limited, it just didn't like that. And I think his work, which is not only music, but tremendous, and he was also, he was a producer, he was a bandleader, he was in a way a visual artist, and he was a politician. And you have, if you have to judge him, you have to see all this in connection to each other. And it's not enough if you say, well,
because of the music that he lived to.
For a final question about the Yellow Shark, what is your favorite piece of the program?
It changes from time to time, but in the moment I'm with Truth is Living. I say also why,
yes.
Because I think he's trying something new there, that it's contrapuntally very complex, which you don't have very often in music. You don't have real counterpoint really, and it's very, you can see a piece as from very different side, and you can hear to it as a very abstract playing around with the sounds. You can listen to it as a kind of dialogue. And you know, between the two pianists, it has this speaking quality which a lot of his music has, and above all, all this seriousness, there's a lightness and you know, this kind of the music really speaks. It really speaks, and despite of it, there's also a kind of tender sadness, which you very rarely have in his music, and forever like.
Okay, one last question about the conversation, because the musicians have already arrived. Is it true that the ensemble were there and made in 1993 last recordings, and that the complete cover of Paris is recorded?
That's right. I mean, we had a lot of ideas, and one we happened to realize, which was to record in his studio, with his technical equipment, with his mind. He was a kind of musical supervisor there, and he made a lot of compositions, you know, for the setting, for the sounds, even for musical details of the various pieces.
Mm.
And we had a lot of plans to do this period, but I'm lucky that we realized what we did.
Okay, Mr. Rundel, very thanks for this conversation.
Thank you.